Concussion comes from the Latin word concussus, which means to violently shake. The brain is violently shaken inside the skull. The frontal parts of the brain bounce off the inner surface of the skull. The occipital parts of the brain bounce off the occipital part of the skull. And then the temporal lobes are very much traumatized in the middle fossa. And in reality, the brain is experiencing both linear, which means longitudinal or in one plane, stretching forces, as well as rotational forces, which are twisting forces that stretch brain tissue even more. And as a result of those stretching of brain tissue, axons and neurons are rendered dysfunctional. Well, the event is the sudden violent shaking. And then the process is that over a period, depending upon the severity of the concussion, that can be minutes, hours, days, weeks, sometimes years, recovery has to happen. And recovery is reestablishing the correct ionic makeup and the correct neurotransmitters back on the axons. That can be negatively influenced if the concussion is not managed properly, and the symptoms can be made to last a lot longer, and sometimes can cause some cells to die that wouldn't otherwise have died.
How does one diagnose a concussion?
It's a clinical diagnosis in every case, and you make the diagnosis by virtue of one of two or both changes that happen to the brain after it has been subjected to traumatic forces, linear and rotational forces. Most of the time, those forces are traumatically induced by a direct blow to the brain or the head striking an object, but they can be indirect blows as well. A violent blow to the chest that snaps your head forward. A violent blow to the back of your thorax that snaps your head back. That also, if they're violent enough, can produce concussion symptoms. What are the symptoms? Well, the symptoms are either A, an alteration in level of consciousness, which on one extreme is coma, unconsciousness, which is uncommon but happens about 5 to 10% of the cases on athletic fields, or simply being stunned, losing orientation for a period of time. So it can be either that and or any one of the other 26 post-concussion symptoms that can be brought on by these traumatic forces, such as difficulty remembering, difficulty concentrating, headache, dizziness, lightheadedness, sensitivity to light, sensitivity to noise, trouble with balance, trouble with coordination, and so on. So you can have no alteration in level of consciousness, just those symptoms occurring, and it's a concussion. Or you can have just alteration in consciousness without those other symptoms, but more often you kind of have both.
How many concussions do you think, and I know it's impossible to know for sure, go undiagnosed?
Probably somewhere between 60% and 80%, and it depends upon the sport. Sports that are at high risk of concussion, like football, ice hockey, for sure, there have been studies. I've been a part of an ice hockey study where they put observers up in the stands, and their job was to look at the rink. And when somebody got up slowly and looked like they may be a bit stunned, yet went back into play, to examine them between periods and determine whether they felt they had a concussion or not. And they found the incidence of concussion was 7 times higher from these physician observers than from the medical personnel on the bench. And there have been numerous football studies by Delaney and others that have shown that if you ask players at the end of the season, when there isn't an issue with peer pressure and coaches looking down on them and all that kind of thing, about whether they've had concussion symptoms, like after a hit, have you ever seen stars? Have you ever lost orientation? Could you not remember the plays? About 60 to 70% of individuals will say yes, during the season at some point they've had these symptoms. So they've obviously had a concussion, and yet only about 5 to 8 or 9% of concussions are recognized in football during a season. So the unrecognized group far exceeds the recognized group.
This excerpt is brought to you by the Massachusetts School of Law, the leader of reform in legal education and a leader in multimedia education for the public. To To view the full interview and for a full listing of MSL's programs, log on to mslaw.edu.